Welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living from Boise, Idaho. I'm Reverend Jackie Holland, and it is my honor, my privilege to welcome you here on this Easter Sunday morning, 2020. We are so excited to see all of you with us, and thank you for whenever you're listening to this or watching this, either right now live with us or later on in the day. Thank you for being with us, for celebrating with us this morning. I want to remind you that at the end, near the end of my talk this morning, we're going to be doing a ritual that you can participate in at your homes. Wherever you are right there, you can participate with us. We ask if you have not already put a candle and a lighter in the room wherever you are. We invite you to put the candle right there. Don't light it yet. It's going to be part of a ritual that we're going to be doing later on. So take a few minutes. In a few minutes, Rex will be playing some lovely meditative music. And if you don't have your candle, we'll have a few minutes so that you can go and get it. Again, I just want to tell you how much it means to all of us here that you're joining us on this beautiful, beautiful spring day. I am, of course, speaking to you from the Center for Spiritual Living, where there are five people in this room all practicing as much safe distancing as is possible to do, and we are just here to bring forth a beautiful Easter service for you, of course. Donna Sheedy, our practitioner, is also on the camera today, and our practitioner of the day that will be bringing forth our spiritual practices is our beloved Deborah Whitman. On sound this morning is our Thomas O'Rourke again, and we have Ed Kay in the church also as my assistant this morning and as our photographer. And our music, always, the best music in Boise, Idaho, even in the midst of a pandemic, the most exciting music in Boise, Idaho on Sunday morning. We are so delighted to have with us this morning the members of our CSL house band. We have Ted McClure, who is here on the bass. We have Phil Bowden, of course, on our drums. We have the magnificent Rex Miller as our musical director. Yes, 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 yes. And again, with us this morning, we're calling her the sweetheart of our church, Miss Lisa Biddick. Yes. This morning, I want to remind you that all of us are going through something different, something unlike anything we've ever done before. All of us are being impacted, and I remind you once again that our musicians are especially being impacted by the closing of their gigs. Please go to our website, cslboise.org, and you can see all about our musicians. You can help support them if you want. Let's just take a few minutes right now. Turn to whoever is in the room with you, right where you are, and maybe you're by yourself. If you're alone, then I want you just to look in the camera right now. And I want you just to wish whoever is in the room with you or speak back to the camera, I want you to say, Happy Easter. Welcome to a new life and a new day. Turn to someone. Take a deep breath with me now. And let's take a few moments where we can gently and lovingly center down from all the hustle and bustle and activity of getting ready for service or getting ready to find Facebook Live. Let's just take a moment and listen to the beautiful meditative music of Rex. Thank you.
science, we believe that all paths lead to God. And so this is to our beloved churches and their ministers and everyone around the world listening to this message. This is a season when hope renews itself. The blossomings of spring symbolize the flowering of spirit upon the tree of life. It is also a time when we enrich the soil, that their roots may reach even more deeply into the creative medium which gives life. Old branches have been cut off, and new ones are growing to take their place. So it is in the perennial spring, time of our spiritual aspirations. The Christ in us stirs anew in the human soul that it may find a deeper root in the universal spirit. And in doing so, lifts its imagination to a new influx from on high. But this new beginning is by our own consent. The resurrection comes only as we permit it to. Let us then unitedly seek that only inspiration that can endure, that only foundation that can withstand the shock of divergent experience, that only solidarity that can find our consciousness deep-rooted in the heart of Mother Love, impregnated by the Divine Father, that we may bear the fruit of Spirit. May the good Lord bless and keep us ever renewing our hope to the day of fulfillment. And now, if you would please join me in prayer. As we take a deep breath in, knowing and recognizing the one presence, the one power, the one infinite source that is life itself, that one divine mind that is the same mind that is in each one of us. No matter who we are or where we are all connected to this divine mind. We are all connected to each other. And so it is with this understanding, with this complete faith, that I speak this word for all of us. That right now we are renewed and strengthened in the spirit. We are renewed by this beloved divine presence that we call God. And so I give thanks today. I give thanks for this service. I give thanks for everyone tuning in and listening. I give thanks for everyone present here that is making this service possible. And it is from this grateful heart that I say a special word. Blessing for Reverend Jackie Holland as she steps up and she allows Spirit to speak through her, to bring forth a message that we are all ready to hear, and we all hear exactly what we need. So it is from this place of faith, from this place of knowing, with a grateful heart, that I release my word. I release it into the law. I let it go, I let it be, and I let God do God's work, whatever that is. And so together we say, Aho, Amen, Ashe,
Ashe,
and so it is.
So it is.
Thank you.
There was a lot of noise. There was a lot of things going on.
But at his death, it's a different story. It is a completely different story. This may be the most realistic Easter that we as a race have ever had since the very first Easter. On that first Easter, it was dark. People were afraid. People were sequestered in their homes. They were afraid to go out. They were afraid of officials. They did not know what was happening. They could not understand what was happening. We hear about earthquakes, which, you know, we had last week. This may be the most authentic Easter we have had ever since the very first one, because we're finding ourselves in the same place. The Easter story is the story of death. It's a story of betrayal, of gruesome agony, of waiting in ignorance and uncertainty, of hearing one story and then another story and then a different story from different people. It's a story of darkness. It's the story of an empty tomb. It's the story of people being separated from each other. This may be the most authentic Easter you will ever spend in your life, because we are finding ourselves in that same place. In religious science, we teach that the Bible, the Christian Bible, is a story of all of our lives, and that we are every character in every story in the Bible. So this Easter story is a story of your life. You are Jesus, wrongfully accused, fulfilling your life purpose. You are the Herod figure. Had them in our families, those who sought to deny our uniqueness, and we either fled away, washed our hands, not taking responsibility. You're the crowds cheering for Jesus last week, cheering for a leader, but the moment that the leader doesn't do what we want him to do, we deny. You are Jesus, alone. But you are also that Christ consciousness that is saying, for this I was born. We are every character in this story. And every character in that story experiences deep emptiness, just like we're experiencing right now. There were no angels announcing this pandemic. There was no hosannas in the sky. There was no outcry for us. No. Between Friday, Good Friday, everything went quiet on Saturday, and we find ourselves here this morning, waiting, waiting for the gift of this time, of where we are. Certainly, those of us that really don't know whether or not this is a true story or not still long for the story, parts of it, to be true. I love what theologian and writer Frederick Buchner wrote. He said this: "It has always struck me as remarkable that when the writers of the four Gospels come to the most important part of the story they have to tell, they tell it in whispers. The part I mean, of course, is the part about the resurrection. According to the Gospels, there was no choir of angels to proclaim it. There was no sudden explosion of light in the sky. Not a single soul was around to see it happen. Who found it first? A few women quietly telling the frightened and quarrelsome disciples. When they heard that he was alive again, the disciples tended to dismiss it as if it was too good to be true. And even when they finally saw him for themselves, they could not be sure." It's like us right now. It's like the story of our life too. We can't be sure of anything right now. We are frightened. We're filled with despair. We want to know what's going on, but we can't be sure. And we even deny. Jesus, the master teacher, was denied by the people who knew him the best. "Do you not know who I am?" In our own lives, right now, we are being called on to be different than we have ever been before. And there will be people in your life when this is over that do not recognize you. That's the resurrection story. That when we let go of the old and we resurrect into the new, we become the new human that we were meant to be. There will be people who will deny you, who will not recognize you. We can take a lesson from the master teacher Jesus when he, with great love in his eyes and gentleness in his voice, we are told, said, "It is I." And in the moment of recognition by the people who loved him the most, there was such a cry of joy, of jubilation. This is what I believe is happening for us right now. That when we come to the end of this pandemic, there will be cries of jubilation and joy. There will be newness for all of us. There will be people who do not recognize us. Jesus, the master teacher, if you believe in the story or if you don't believe in the literal story of the resurrection, but listening to the story as it was written by, none of the men were there, by the way, who wrote the story, but when we read it, they tell us that he came back from death, not in a blaze of glory, but like a candle flame in the dark, flickering first this place and that place and no place at all. Maybe that's what this is about. Maybe this darkness is to teach us that our resurrection isn't about an explosion. It's not about a giant firecracker going off, but it is the gentle flicker of a candlelight, like our Christ candle that's lit behind me this morning. I'm guessing that many of you listening or watching this may not believe in the resurrection of the physical body of Jesus. Look, I'm going to tell you, nobody really knows what happened. That's why my Christmas ad this year said, "Look, join us. We don't really know what happened." Because we really don't know. We're not sure what happened. We do know that the early Christians took pagan holidays, and Esther, who of course was the goddess of the egg, and we could go into that story, and we will another time. It was a pagan holiday that the Christians melded with their holiday, so hey, I don't know what really happened. But the resurrection story of Easter is one that some people of faith claim as literal and factual, the tangible proof of their faith and evidence that they are a people saved from permanent death. I don't know if it literally is true, but I know it would not have been impossible. I know that this would be nothing for a God that is as big as spirit is. I don't even think that it matters. Some of us embrace it as a symbolic reminder of the things that we have to overcome in life. That it's life breaking through us, breaking us down, something new being birthed into us, in us. So the resurrection then is a glorious rebirth that's happening to us in our everyday life. Listen, even if the Gospels do not describe a factual occurrence, maybe it's not scientifically provable, but there is something in this story that all of us long to be true. I can only speak for myself, but the master teacher Jesus taught me that we can be resurrected from anything in our lives that is not true to the nature that spirit breathed into us the moment that it moved in an act of love and recreated itself as you. Whatever truth there is in the Easter story doesn't really matter. We know that the gospel writers almost whisper this story as if it's too good to be true. And that's what's happening, I think, right now. For all of us, we can make some pretty good guesses about this. What really happened? What really happened? The point, I think, of the Easter story for me is that it doesn't matter. It's a lesson for me to let go of what I think it should be and simply allow the story to become a part of the fabric of my own life, especially now in this pandemic. The great lesson is that we have to let go of the how and of the when and even of the why. And we have to simply allow the love of God to move through us in a new way. We have to surrender and trust in the power and the presence and the magnificence of God Almighty. That is the resurrection story for me today. We believe that the story is the story of our life, and we tend to focus on the teachings of Jesus. And one of the most important parts of Jesus' life that has meaning for me now, during this pandemic especially, is Jesus was a man who built community. He brought his disciples together and people together and the women together. He washed feet. He fed the hungry. Community was critical to the master teacher Jesus. I think about his disciples when he died. How sad, how sorrowing, how grieving they must have been. He was the central focus of their community. They ate together. They argued theological points together. They wept together. They were a family, a community. And when Jesus died, that ended for them momentarily their community. And when they came back together, it must have been difficult for them. Very much like what we are going through today. But what they discovered, was that when Jesus was resurrected, it wasn't the man Jesus that brought the community back together, but it was the teaching, the essence of the man Jesus. This is what we are all facing, because I know that it can happen for us too. Right now, we are missing community. We are missing family. We are missing this church. We are grieving the loss, as I am, of four friends in the last 2 weeks who have died from the virus. Here on the ground, whether we claim a religious worldview or not, we all face the stark reality that people that we have lost will not physically come back and greet us on the path of our grieving. That we are not going to be given an Easter morning miracle of their rebirth. We are being taught and learning that people we love get sick and die. But because of the coronavirus's presence, this strange Easter Sunday, so marked by physical distancing, even those that we are grieving their losses, we are so separated. We can hold on to the bittersweet story of Jesus' resurrection this morning and realize it wasn't the resurrection of his body that mattered. It was the resurrection of the essence of who he was, what he taught, and what we have come to believe as a result of this magnificent man. And that is the truth for all of us that are losing or have lost someone. This story is retold year after year, season after season. And the resurrection story is told in our own lives day after day. But our resurrection stories are smaller. Our resurrection stories are stories about a person like our beloved LaDonna, who recovers from cancer, and like our beloved Lydia. These are resurrection stories. A resurrection story of a couple that reunites after a separation. A resurrection story is the story of a man who puts down a bottle for the first time. Or an individual goes back to school. This is the true Easter story. The true Easter story is that when we come to that place that we consider a dead end, when the stone is rolled in front of our life and we move into the darkness, that there is a promise that a resurrection can happen. This is the story of Easter. This is what it stands for. New life, resurrection occur every moment. Every day. It is the gift of the resiliency of the human spirit. It is the proof that we will rise in spite of what we are being given. But we have to be reminded every day of our resurrections, small and large. When we give our full attention to whatever we are doing, we recognize the constant renewal of things in our lives that are going on all around us. When we walk in the path of beauty and notice the spiritual radiance of this spring and of other people, that's a resurrection. Whenever we, with compassion, open our hearts, our minds, and our souls to the pain of the world, we help bring suffering to an end, and that is a resurrection. When we consciously make connections and the walls of separation come crashing down and we embrace the concept of oneness, that is a resurrection. When we regularly pray for other people as part of our sacred spiritual practices, we are practicing resurrection. When we can laugh and sing and dance, we are resurrecting joy in our world. Every time we reach out to someone that we have had a disruption of a relationship with, a sister that you haven't spoken to in years, that is a resurrection. Every time you forgive someone, there is another resurrection in the making. When you work for justice, freedom, and equality, you're setting the stage for resurrection for millions of people around our world. When you stand up and speak your truth, you're participating in rolling the stone away from the darkness that we have found ourselves in. When we make peace, when we practice reverence for life, when we welcome change, big or small, when we work together as one, we are opening ourselves to transformation and resurrection. So to have the message of resurrection whispered in our ear, we've heard it before. We just haven't been listening. We haven't stopped from our daily activities and listened to life as it's resurrecting itself all around us. And with this pandemic, we have no choice. We know that this is the most important message we have ever received in our lives. The message that life, new life, and a new way of being can emerge from death. This pandemic is a death in more ways than just of the body temple. This pandemic is the death of the old ways of doing things, the old ways of believing what we have believed and acting in certain ways and using Mother Earth and conspicuous consumption. What will rise from this? What will rise? And so this morning, where so many of you are in your homes and you are alone, I know that this Easter will magnify some of our losses. That some of us are in breathtaking grief, in painful silence, in deep and profound waiting. For many, it's underscoring the loneliness that we have felt for a long time. But we will eventually be released from this, to return, I hope, not to being normal, but with a new stone that has been rolled away from our old way of being, our old way of believing. So I can only tell you that's why we come here this Easter morning together. I don't know what you're going to do when this talk ends, whether you'll go and have your traditional Easter ham, which never made much sense to me. Think about it for a second. Maybe this Easter you'll celebrate it in a different way, in a quiet introspection of your life and what's going on around you. Something happened that day. We don't know what it was, but we do know this, that we are here now, that we are living now, that we are loving now, that we are resurrecting our lives right now. We are forming community in a new way, and so this morning I just embrace you right where you are. I embrace you with all of the love that is in my heart this morning. And I wish you a blessed and a beautiful and a loving Easter. I am reminded of a story that I heard over and over when I was a little girl. It was about a school teacher, a Sunday school teacher, who said to, let's call her Mildred. She said to Mildred, that's a name I've never had, so you won't think it's me. But she said to Mildred, she said, what do you think the first words of Jesus were when he stepped out of the tomb? He had been in the tomb now, dark. What do you think his first words were? And little Mildred said, ta-da! Well, this isn't a ta-da the kind of day, is it? But we can make it that. This morning, we want to just take a moment as Rex comes back up. We just want to take a moment now and just let's gently and lovingly move with him. In a moment, we're going to participate in our ritual. So get your candle and your lighter ready as Deborah Whitman and Donna Sheedy are going to be participating with me in a ritual in a few moments. But right now, I'd like you just to take a deep breath. Feel that air entering into those strong, healthy lungs. Gently, if you're comfortable, I want you to close your eyes. I want to read a poem from a woman by the name of Veronica Vales, or Valley, I'm not sure. And for a moment, I want you to move into the tomb with me. We won't stay here, I promise, and we'll have a ta-da moment in just a few minutes. Just gently focus on your breath. This is the moment where I'm asking you to enter into the darkness of that which no longer is serving you. Judgment. Procrastination. Envy. Low self-esteem. These are all in my tomb. Truth emerges from the crevices. write a new gospel of the wounded healer who awakens. Take a breath. As you are rocked in the arms of the beloved, dwell in the fruitful darkness. A journey of time into truth, into love, into the Spirit. Turning poison into medicine, drink of this deliberate infusion. Sit in the silence. Do not run or hide or lunge for the light. The secrets of the mystery lie within the shadows. Surrender to the formless one. Enter deeper. Enter deeper. This time of introspection is gifting you with this now. Let it go. Not my will, but thy will be done, O God. Take this cup. Take this quality that has been revealed away from me now. Take another deep breath with me and let it go. Take another deep cleansing breath and release it. Don't you feel lighter? Ta-da! Here is the light. The essence of the Christ consciousness is the flicker of a candle, lighting your path, lighting your way. I don't know what the story really means, but it is profound if we open our hearts. Several weeks ago, or last week, I believe, we did a meditation together, our High Noon meditation, where I led you into a meditation of allowing Spirit to reveal to you what quality of God itself is trying to be birthed in you now, what seed is being planted in you now, that when this is over and you emerge, this is who you are. So many of you responded to CSLBoise.org. So many of you responded to that meditation. And right now, if you're watching this live, or later, if you're listening, you can send your quality to us, because when we come back, whenever we can come back together as a community, we're going to be celebrating those qualities in a tangible way. But today, our practitioners, these magnificent consciousness of healing, light, and love, Donna Sheedy and Deborah Whitman, are going to be bringing forth a ceremony so that you can, right now, declare this quality. Practitioners of truth and light, please join us. Thank you.
these qualities of God that you sent in, we are going to light some candles and I will read them off. So we will light the first candle for patience, laughter, and mindfulness. We will light the second candle for grace, peace, and light. We light the third candle for mastery, divine love, and compassion. We light the fourth candle for health, prosperity, and luck. We light the fifth candle for faith, gratitude, wisdom, and joy. And now if you would join me again, Donna Sheedy and I again in prayer. As we absolutely know that these qualities of God are qualities found in everyone, everywhere. And we recognize that every time we see someone, every time we are in someone's company, it doesn't matter, we recognize these qualities of God. And so now, allow these qualities to shine forth from you. Allow them to be present within you and to be a part of who you are. Share them with everyone, knowing that these qualities are ever present, ever available, ever ready. We let them come forth now. We release anything that is not serving us. We release it and we allow ourselves to be resurrected in the new.
Recognize these God qualities. I know right where I am that this God is, as it comes through me, as me, and in me. And I absolutely know the same divine truth for every single person within the sound of my voice, that each of these beautiful creatures are perfect whole manifestations of spirit right now. They are their quality right now, right here. Every breath that they take, every thought that they have, and every action that they do.
And so as we ponder these words, these qualities of God, let us just allow it to sink in. Let us allow it to enter and be that part of us, that deep, deep part of us. For we know absolutely, absolutely, the very essence of our being is God. And God is all of these qualities and so much more. And so from this place, I gratefully, I release it into the law, I let it go, I let it be, and we let God do God's work. And so it is.
the light. So, you know, I'm not a person who watches reality television. I'm really not. But I remember one time watching something on television and thinking, don't those people know that there's a camera on them? So I'm quite sure that this photo bombing of me running back to get a microphone for Donna was like, so no, we're not used to these cameras, so forgive, if there was a photo bomb, please forgive me, okay? Anyway, I have to laugh, I was so afraid the officials would see you passing off the microphone to get a nervous, nervous, so thank you. Coming out of the darkness into the light, wow. Lisa Biddick, ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you. And this amazing, incredible, incredible CSL house band, I'm telling you, we are just so blessed. I want to just say, what a crazy time. What new things we're all learning how to be, especially one of the ways that we are learning how to do is to support our church financially in this absence. I know many of you, like me, miss that basket coming in front of you so that you can, with such love and joy, place your offering in that basket. I miss that myself. I do. And I just want to say thank you to all of the individuals who mail your checks in. And I don't know where our basket is, but we will symbolically, that's all right, we'll symbolically hold on to these and just know that that which you have so generously and lovingly given to us through the generosity of your heart and the love of your spiritual community. We want to say thank you on behalf of the community, the entire community that is being supported. The ministries are up and running. Our practitioner corps is working diligently. We are reaching out to members of this community. Every person should be receiving a call in the next couple of weeks. The next week or so, if you haven't, you know, give me a call. We really, really, really want you to know that every time you have reached out to this church for prayer, we are praying. We are still, our compassionate care ministry is up and going, helping people. Very, very busy church, even with the doors closed. And so thank you. You are making that possible. You're making it possible for the our beautiful gardens. Thank you to Reverend Janine to stay up with water, lights to be on, phone and computers running. We thank you. I wish sometimes that church wasn't a business, but it is. And I am reminded that Jesus, the master teacher, when he, of course, did not have a job that we know of, was supported by the generosity of his community. So once again, on behalf of the Board of Trustees and all of us here at the Center for Spiritual Living, thank you. You can send your checks. Go to cslboise.org, cslboise.org. So much information there, our phone numbers, our addresses. You can send a check, you can send cash, you can tell your bank, as many of these people have done, to send a check to the church. Or you can continue to do auto-tithing, which many of you have done. And you can do, there's a mobile giving app. We've got a mobile giving text right now. You could text, give CSL Boise. You could text the number 208-782-4202, 208-782-4202. And if you just put in your CSL, and you can put the amount in any way that you can give, we're so deeply appreciative. Everything matters, everything. No amount is too small, so thank you once again. And I thank you for your willingness to participate in this promissory note, which is called money, which is the promise of circulation in your life and in the life of our economy and in the life of this church. We are deeply grateful to you. And so let's just right now symbolically take our gift, our offering in our hand at home right where you are. Place your hand on your heart as a recognition that you are sending love as well as financial support. Just right there, just put your hand on your heart as together all of us in this room say, divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, and all that I circulate, and so it is. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, from the Center for Spiritual Living here in beautiful Boise, Idaho, I want to wish you a blessed, happy, and joy-filled Easter. Peace and blessings. See you online. Ladies and gentlemen, Lisa Billick with the CSL House Band.
Wisdom and faith to step into the light. Peace and blessings.